I was there, he would say afterwards, until afterwards became a time quite devoid of laughter. I was there the day Horus slew the Emperor. It is rare for an Astartes to exceed the legend of his Primarchs, or even become integral to the enduring legacy of the Imperium. Yet rarer still, it is possible for a fallen Space Marine to rise again to face the darkness, alone. For today we shall resume our elucidation of the Lunar Wolf, once known as Garviel Loken, the man who would become known as Cerberus. On the desolate wasteland of Istvaan III, a new type of war had been concluded. The bodies of Astartes, the Emperor's angels, lay cold and broken. Their deaths the first of their kind, and all the more tragically enacted by their own brethren. Emperor's children, world-eaters, Death Guard and Sons of Horus, loyal to the Emperor, had paid for their devotion to the ideals of humanity. Blighted by virus bombs, scorched by orbital bombardment, and quelled by the blades and bolters of traitorous brothers, all traces of loyalty on Istvaan had ceased. Yet amongst the rubble, debris and corpses of slain angels, an Astartes would rise. Within the Choral City, the man once known as Garviel Loken would awaken, dazed and disoriented, from his battle against the first lieutenant of the Warmaster, Ezekiel Abaddon. Traumatized from the death of his most beloved comrade, Tarik Torgaddon, the Astartes would observe his brother's lifeless body and guard it from the carrion scavengers that roamed the wastes. His identity lost, and the scars of battle set deep within his flesh, the revenant Astartes would name himself Cerberus. The Hound Guardian of the Underworld, it would be a fitting name for a fallen Lunar Wolf. Believing himself to be rejected from the embrace of death itself, Cerberus would scour the wastes of Istvaan III and slay the remaining survivors for a Terran standard year. Believing the wounded Astartes to be traitors, the monster of Istvaan would believe itself to be the last loyal Space Marine in existence. Yet Cerberus would be discovered by another stalwart loyal Astartes, the former Death Guard battle captain, Nathaniel Garro. Dispatched by Malcadore the Sigillite, the Knights Errant consisting of Garro, Mace of Arran, and Tylos Rubio would search the ruins of Istvaan III for survivors. Discovering the corpse of Torgaddon, Garro would be attacked by the near-feral Astartes, Cerberus. After a lengthy duel between Garro and Cerberus, the world-eater Mace of Arran would convince Garro to stay his hand in harming the broken Astartes. The battle would be interrupted due to their being surrounded by the foul demon hosts of the plague god, Nurgle, and face the many plague zombies and thralls of the ruinous powers. As their duel resumed, Garro would reach through to Cerberus's humanity and convince the monster of Istvaan III to relent, proving their intention to preserve humanity and face the foul beings of chaos. Cerberus would be reminded of his true identity and join the Knights Errant in their venture to the Soul System. Brought before the Somnus Citadel on the moon of Luna, Cerberus would be interrogated by the agents of the Sigillite. Treated initially with suspicion and fear, Loken's trust to the Imperium would be under scrutiny. Yet with the endorsement of Nathaniel Garro, Malcadore, and even the Primarch of the Imperial Fists, Rogal Dorn, Loken would be declared loyal to the throne, despite his many detractors. Finding no evidence of treachery during his interrogation, Loken would be inducted into Malcadore the Sigillite's clandestine order, the Knights Errant. For his skill as a warrior would be tested, with his first mission alongside his old mentor and Lunar Wolf brother, Eacton Cruz. Ordered to infiltrate the First Legion homeworld of Caliban, Loken and Cruz would attempt to ascertain clarity on the Dark Angel's loyalty to the Imperium and the strength they could bring to bear. Infiltrating the fortress monastery of Alderuk, Loken would intentionally be captured by the Dark Angels and be interrogated by the Regent of Caliban, Lufa. Answering only to the name of Cerberus, Luther would nonetheless identify Loken as a member of the 16th Legion due to his noticeable Chthonian accent. Mentioning his collaboration with the Lunar Wolves in prior campaigns, such as Cardensine and Zaramund, Luther would trigger Loken to be consumed by flashbacks and memories of his former service to the 16th. Despite this, Loken would determine that Luther had little to no idea of the conflict raging throughout the galaxy, and would question the Dark Angel's loyalty. Yet with Luther leaving the cell, Loken would be confronted by a strange guardian of Caliban, a Watcher in the Dark. Imbuing Loken with a fraction of its power to read others, Loken would sense Luther's intent. With no explanation to its own intervention, the Watcher would free Loken from his bonds and allow him to escape. Ambushed by the Lord Cipher of the Dark Angels, Loken's mission would seem to be over, yet the mysterious figure would aid in Loken's escape. During the escape, Loken and Cipher would find a Dark Angel sentry blocking their path, to which Yakton Cruz would slay the legionary. Despite Loken's anger to his actions, Cruz would dismiss Loken's chastisement as necessary to allow their mission to succeed, stating that the Dark Angel had not been the first loyal servant of the Imperium he had slain, nor would he be the last. With Cypher's aid, the Lunar Wolves would escape Caliban. Relaying their findings to Rogal Dorn at the Somnus Citadel, they would inform him that although Luther's ambition and resentment may split the Legion, Lionel Johnson's intent, and that of the wider Legion, would be unknown. Despondent with the Sigilite's means of waging war, Loken would feel the weight of his fractured sanity press upon him. Retreating to his inner chambers, his isolation would further wear his psyche down as he began to see illusions casting his slain brother, Tarik. Tending to the plant life within his biodome chambers, Loken would nurture an appreciation for creation, which would bring him a sense of peace. Struggling with the failure of his mission to Caliban, Loken was a warrior no longer waging war, a legionary without a legion, and an outsider even amongst a band comprised of discarded Astartes. Visited by the spectre of Tarik Torgaddon, whether an apparition or the madness of his own mind made manifest, Loken would slowly begin to piece together the shattered shards of his mind. Recovering forgotten memories, Loken would realize the garden he tended was a subconscious recreation of the Water Garden, wherein he had taken his vows to join the Mournival. His oath to serve the Emperor above all, to uphold the Imperial truth, and to assail any evil that defied his Imperium, Torgaddon would remind Loken of his pledge. Unlocking disturbing and overwhelming memories of the fall of his Legion, Loken would attempt to forget his past. Yet Torgaddon would remind him that he was a Lunar Wolf, and nothing was more deadly than a cornered wolf. Confronted as to his true nature, Torgaddon would not give an easy explanation. Departing, Tarik would leave before the arrival of Yakton Cruz into Loken's chamber, bringing a summons from the Sigilite. The now reinvigorated Garviel Loken would depart with his battle brother to face whatever darkness ensued. Malcadore and the Primarch of the Space Wolves, Leman Russ, had devised a mission to slay the Warmaster. Conspiring with the aid of Loken's knowledge of the 16th Legion, the Space Wolves and Knights Errant would attempt to board the Sons of Horus flagship, the Vengeful Spirit. Above the world of Molech, the Knights Errant would infiltrate the ship ahead of the assault of the Space Wolves to mark the way for the rout to claim their prize. Alongside Tylos Rubio, Mesa Varan, Iacton Cruz, Rama Karayan, Aeris Wojtek, Altan Nohai, Kalian Zarvin, and Tubal Cain, Loken would command the strike team. Yet at the behest of Russ, Braw Tearfinger would accompany the Knights Errant as their newest inductee. Despite the Lunar Wolf Severian's conviction that the mission would be predestined to fail, he would later rejoin the Knights Errant as they boarded the Vengeful Spirit. Infiltrating with the stealth vessel, Tarnhelm, under the planning of once Iron Warrior, Tubal Cain, the Knights would infiltrate the vessel undetected. Braw Tearfinger would leave Fufark runes to aid his Legion's imminent assault, yet eventually, the knights would be discovered. As their numbers dwindled during the skirmishes throughout the ship, the knights would eventually make their way to the Lupercal court. Confronted by the Warmaster, Horus Lupercal would attempt to convince Loken to rejoin his legion. Defying his Gene-Father, Loken would bide time for his knights to set upon the Sons of Horus. As the Tarnhelm blasted the court's windows of the audience chamber, the knights would make their escape. Losing more of their number, with injuries incurred upon Mesa Varan, Wojtek, and the ultramarine centurion, Proximo Tarkon, the scarred knights would return to Luna with their failure weighing heavily on their shoulders. Bror Tearfinger and Severian would convince Loken that the mission's failure had not been his fault, yet Loken would nonetheless prepare for the inevitable traitor assault on Holy Terra. During the Siege of Terra, the knights would aid the Imperium forces in slaying the many chaos infestations and outbreaks that beset the surface. Alongside Nathaniel Garro, Mesa Varan, Vardas Ison, and Helig Galor, the knights would defend the subterranean fortress of White Mountain. Deployed onto the fortress's slopes, the knights errant would face the demons of chaos and the nemesis of Nathaniel Garro, the Lord of Flies. Mortally wounded, the loyalist World Eater Mesa Varan would be possessed by the Lord of Flies and contemplate attacking his brethren. Yet at the sight of Garviel Loken, Varan would be reminded of his struggle and unyielding loyalty to the Emperor. Confronted by Loken, Varan would be reminded of their friendship and his words that had saved Loken's life during their initial encounter, resolving that he would never be controlled by anyone nor anything. Varan would detonate a brace of grenades from Loken's armor and sacrifice himself to prevent the demon from harming his battle brothers. As the demon fled from Varan's ruined body, the arrival of Malcadore the Sigilite would see to the psychic immolation of the demon, and with the end of the siege, the Knights Errant would survive the Horus Heresy. With the war over, the Knights would meet with the Emperor himself, whom would create a new order comprised of the nine Knights Errant from whom had survived the trials of the heresy. Forming the Grey Knights chapter, these Astartes would combat the demons of the warp to free humanity of their corrupting influence. Yet despite all adopting new names and joining the order, Loken would refuse such an offer. Unwilling to start anew, Garviel Loken would realize his destiny was not to become a Grand Master of the newly founded order. Instead, Loken would resolve to face the Sons of Horus, wherever they may have fled to. His vengeance against his former brothers must be sated, and a wolf cast out from the pack can never relent in its quest for vengeance.
"Garviel,"
said Horus, and he turned to see the Warmaster holding out his gauntlet.
"Don't hate me for what's happened."
"Why shouldn't I hate you?" said Loken. "You did the worst things that anyone can do to another person. You let us believe we were loved and valued, then showed us it was all a lie." Horus shook his head, but his hand remained outstretched. Behind him, a crenellated warship passed over the face of the moon. The eye of Horus adorned its prow, but it was a crude thing, painted on like graffiti.
"Come back to me, my son. We can rebuild what was lost between us. Renew our bonds of fellowship. I want you at my side as I reforge the Imperium anew."
Loken looked back at the warriors on their knees behind him, men he'd called brother in the darkest of times. He looked into their eyes, seeing their defiance and more. Rubio's fists were clenched, and the tension in Wojtek's neck was like a straining machine about to throw a gear. He saw the cold eyes of Bror Tearfinger upon him, and remembered the words he had spoken at their first meeting.
"I think if your roots are weak, I'll kill you myself."
He gave an almost imperceptible nod to his fellows, and took a step away from the Warmaster, feeling the threads of loyalty and brotherhood that bound him to this moment pull tight.
"Part of me wishes I could, sir," said Loken. "Believe me, I want the warmth that being part of something greater brings. I want to belong. I had that with the Legion, but you took that away from me when you stabbed us all in the back."
"No,"
said Horus.
Garviel, no. That's not—
But Loken wasn't about to stop now. Turning my back on everything I knew, being cut off from the Legion that made me who I am, that was the worst moment of my life. It drove me insane. More than Tarik's death, or being buried alive on Istvaan, it was the heartbreak and yawning emptiness that finally broke me.
Then come back to me, Garviel,
said Horus.
Feel that warmth again. Don't you want to be part of the greatest endeavor the galaxy has ever seen?
I already was, said Loken, turning his back on Horus. It was called the Great Crusade. This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. It has been a year since we first elucidated Garviel Loken and began the Chronicles of Remembrance. Let his story remind us of our strength, our will, and indomitable loyalty. No matter the might of our enemies or their honeyed words, we shall remain human and never fall to the lure of chaos, nor its accursed champions.